Today we're talking about Argentina, a country doing so badly, Evita might start crying for them. So why are we talking about Argentina today? Because it's certainly not for the clicks. Well, first, I'm a huge nerd, and I love making the occasional episode about interesting economic problems across the world. More relevantly, though, they've recently been on the receiving end of a 1-2 punch of a debt crisis and a separate currency crisis, and they just elected a new administration with a plan to scratch the surface of this problem. Our story starts in 2015 with the election of President Mauricio Macri. Macri took office in 2015 on the back of promises to reverse the interventionist policy of his predecessor and get the country's stalled economy moving again. Now, to his credit, he did get the economy moving again, just not in the direction he was hoping. Hey, downward is still a direction, technically. Now, he introduced a series of reforms that weren't unreasonable at the time, with two goals. First, increase Argentinian exports, and second, get the government out of the expensive and inefficient business of controlling currency values, and transfer that power to the private markets. He cut export taxes, lifted currency controls, and resolved a 15-year-long dispute with holders of defaulted Argentinian bonds, allowing Argentina to resume access to international capital markets. The central bank also raised interest rates to 25% to curb inflation. Now I realize that's a lot to take in, but it makes a lot of sense if you start to give it a narrative. Let's start with the first reform.
Over the last year, while the official exchange rate was fixed around 9 Argentine pesos to the dollar, a dollar fetched as much as 16 pesos on the black market. Businesses, especially those needing to deal in dollars, were deeply affected.
You heard that right, a black market for currency. Hey, you wanna buy some cash? I've got a dime bag right here. Nah, this isn't that weak European currency, this is the strong American green that'll get your savings high. So what's going on here? Well, the previous administration had a two-pronged approach to managing the economy. The first prong was to completely ignore the market value for their currency, and instead buy and sell that currency for a set price. If you see some huge holes in that logic, hold your horses, because most of that will be addressed in the second prong. For now though, the government is buying the Argentinian peso for more than market value. It would literally be me saying, hey, I'll give you a dollar for that quarter. The goal here is to essentially peg the value of that quarter at a dollar. Because I could sell this quarter to the government for a dollar, so shopkeep, you should value it at a dollar too. Now anybody with an IQ above room temperature probably had the thought, well then why not sell a quarter to the government for a dollar and then exchange that dollar on the private market for 4 quarters? Exchange those 4 quarters for $4, rinse and repeat until you're the next Michael Bloomberg. Well, that brings us to the second prong.
Former President Cristina Fernandez Kirchner restricted foreign currency purchases in 2011 to shore up dwindling foreign currency reserves. Most Argentines who wanted to buy dollars were limited to a few hundred dollars a month, when U.S. currency was available in banks at all. Now, that's been changed.
This is, of course, where the black market I mentioned earlier comes in. Because if the government says, hey, we'll buy your quarter for a dollar, but we'll only sell you $2 a month, then, okay, you get your $2, and then you get your spending money in the form of pesos, but that leaves the money you're gonna save. It's not exactly a secret that the government is propping up the currency, so at some point in the future, the government is probably gonna stop that program. And all of a sudden, that quarter, well, is worth a quarter again. Might want to illegally invest some of that money into cash in a more stable currency. It's basically putting your money into gold, except in this case, the gold is United States dollars. To bring this all into the real world and jump forward in this story for a second, Argentina's currency, the peso, has lost 2/3 of its value since 2018. This means that had you illegally put your money into dollars, which went down about 1% during that period, congratulations! You now have about 3 times the savings you would have had if you had faith in the government maintaining this program. So, in ending the government's regulation of the currency, what was the plan to address this problem? Well, the immediate aftermath of this decision left this late 2015 drop. Talk about a fiscal cliff. The longer-term solution was, get the central bank to raise the key interest rate. The central bank also raised interest rates to 25% to curb inflation. Here's a graph of the central bank's interest rate, and here's them boldly raising their rate to 25% in late 2015. And, wow, what the heck is coming down the pipe for us?
Argentina's central bank has raised interest rates to 60%, up from 45%, as the country's currency continues to plummet in value.
Back to 2015, though, because everything was still looking alright. The plan was to fight the inflation removing currency controls would cause by raising the interest rate an amount that, at the time, was considered a pretty radical amount. And all you Fed heads who watch my coverage of Jerome Powell, in this Argentinian context, we're thinking of the Fed's role in a very different way. Why would the Federal Reserve drastically raise interest rates in the face of a massive crisis? Well, when you're facing a currency crisis, your goal is to get people spending as little money as possible. Let me put it this way. When people think of inflation, they tend to only think of money supply. If you're a government and you print money to pay for things, you're gonna get inflation. Simple. But what if, hypothetically, you were a government that printed a ton of money and then immediately locked that money in a safe and didn't let anybody know? The amount of money in existence would have drastically changed, but the currency's value hasn't changed. The goal here is to get people to voluntarily lock up their money and throw away the key, so it retains its value. You do this by raising the interest rates on savings accounts, which is essentially what the Federal Reserve was doing here. This sucks up money out of the economy and helps raise the value of the currency, in theory. This leads to one final question you're probably asking yourself. Why do any of this? I mean, as bad as the old system seemed, it seems to have been working. The main reason is, you can't really do much outside of your borders if you almost exclusively do your legitimate business in the Argentine peso.
Those who want to export will be able to export without asking for permission. Those who want to import can import without permission. Those who want to buy dollars can buy dollars. Those who want to sell dollars, no one is going to go after them. This is how a normal economy functions in any part of the world.
It also had to do with the last major pillar to collapse and lead to the crisis. Financing. The previous administration's strategy for financing their budget deficit was to print money and shake down the local banks to buy bonds at favorable terms. Which is, well, the opposite of sustainable. Macri instead set out to sell bonds on the international market to balance the budgets, a decision that came with higher interest rates. So with those dominoes all set up, what happened? Well, foreign financing started pouring in.
We suddenly have the opportunity to lend money to Argentina for 10 years at a rate of 7.5%, which begs the question, what is the Weimar Republic yielding these days?
That's it. I want to defend the Argentines here slightly.
Hey, the New Yorker called, and they want their snooty sense of almost humor that exactly five people understand back. The investor's defense of the Argentinian loans shows how someone could have been optimistic, and exactly why Argentina is so screwed today.
These debts are in dollars, so you don't need to worry about the inflation side of things. Mm. And where else can you get an emerging market, frontier market story where there's solid reform going on? So 7.5% sure as hell beats sort of 6% you get for Brazil, which is heading the other way, or 1% in the States.
Wow, that deal sounds almost too good to be true. Yes, Argentina, as a country, has a horrible credit rating. So in order to sell bonds internationally, they have to make all sorts of concessions. Such as high interest, and more brutally for Argentina, make all of the terms of their bonds in United States dollars. Now this is particularly brutal because if, say, I write the terms of a government bond so that you give me $100 now, but I give you that same amount, $100 in a year, But in that same period, my currency loses two-thirds of its value. Forget a 7% interest rate. The principal on that loan just got three times as expensive because I have to convert my local currency to US dollars in order to pay it off. It was during those next 2 years that we saw, well, probably not the immediate crisis you were expecting. The Macri government issued $56 billion in external debt between January 2016 and June 2018, and things grew moderately. Oddly enough, there was so much foreign currency pouring in from these international bond sales that the Argentinian Central Bank was actually able to, on the free market, buy Argentinian pesos and give dollars, effectively locking up even more of the Argentinian currency and raising its value. Capital inflows into the country to finance the deficit contribute to an overvaluation of the peso by 10-25%. Macri was left asking the question, wait, did we just pull this off? Well, then the dark clouds of reality set in. Three things happened in 2017 that hurt these prospects. First, something happened in American finance.
Three rate hikes in 2017, not two. They still expect three in 2018.
In a completely unrelated story, America raised their key interest rate, which meant you could start making more money investing in less risky American assets than buying new Argentinian ones. People started selling their Argentine assets in bulk, which made it virtually impossible for them to get any new loans at an affordable interest rate. At the same time,
here in Argentina this year, they're counting the cost of one of the worst droughts in decades, which wiped out nearly a third of its agricultural production.
We're not talking Saudi Arabian levels of going all in on one asset, but Argentina makes over half of their money from agricultural exports. So to have a significant blow to revenue combined with a lack of new money coming in to keep the budget balanced from foreign investors, well, that's not a good combination of events. Macri tried to calm the markets by saying he'd make cuts to the budget and prioritize paying down the debt over social programs. But that didn't seem to help, and also didn't help its chances of re-election in 2020 very much. It's at this point that we see the value of the peso drop and Argentinian central bank interest rates really skyrocket. Please don't desperately spend your money. Make it into a paper airplane. Set it on fire. Just get it out of the economy. If you lock it up, we'll give you a 40% interest rate. Sure, it's probably going to go down in value about 60%, but you might break even. Now, this rapid drop in peso value, as we mentioned earlier, made their debt exponentially harder to pay, and further deteriorated investors' confidence that they would ever get a cent back on their investment. So, might as well sell.
Argentina's peso plummeted to a new historic low against the US dollar on Monday, despite the government's effort to shore up the currency. The central bank has already raised its benchmark interest rate to 40%.
Unfortunately for the government, well, that high interest rate worked, and people saved their money. Economic activity plunged, and on the back of everything else, a recession started. So what do you do when you, as a government, have a three-pronged problem? Your revenue is down, you don't have access to new loans, and those loans that you have taken out over the past few years are about to expire, and you're not really sure how you're going to pay them off. Well, you could pull a Puerto Rico, or a redo of what Argentina did in 2001, and default on billions of dollars in debt. Or you could reach out to one last group.
It's going to be the biggest ever bailout that the IMF has ever issued, in fact. Argentina is to receive an extra $7 billion on top of the $50 billion that it agreed in June as the country battles a currency crisis that's seen the peso lose half of its value so far this year.
Ah, yes, the International Monetary Fund. The people you go to for money when you don't have good enough credit to make a deal with the devil. They accepted a record-breaking biggest loan in IMF history, $57 billion. Still though, money without a plan isn't really that helpful. Don't worry though, the IMF had a plan. IMF Managing Director Christine Lagarde released a statement explaining the terms. They were pretty simple. could basically be summarized as, hey, if you cut regulations and don't spend money on anything, we'll give you the money to balance your balanced budget. It was actually a pretty logical extension of the platform Macri had ran on, deregulating markets and cutting spending. Although we kind of skipped over a fair amount of the budget cut goals in the two pre-crisis years. Step 1. Stop spending money you don't have. A central element of the authority's plan will be to reach a budgetary balance by 2019, and to move to a 1% primary surplus in 2020. Wow, a profitable government by 2020? Do you know about some yet-to-be-discovered oil reserves? In reality, the savings are supposed to come from postponing infrastructure projects, cutting subsidies and transfers to provinces, and shrinking the federal payroll. Basically, the plan for this project reads like Paul Ryan's dream board. On the other hand, we had the enormous problem of inflation. How do you handle this huge problem without intervention? To tackle inflation, the authorities will shift towards a stronger, simpler, and verifiable monetary policy regime, replacing the inflation targeting regime with a monetary base target. This new framework will contain the supply of money and keep short-term interest rates at their currently high levels, aiming to bring down inflation and inflation expectations decisively and rapidly. Yeah, the current strategy was not working at all. Our inflation target is 2%. Sir, inflation is consistently at over 50%. Well then, I know we're doing pretty much everything we can, but let's just keep doing that, and maybe shift our target to a more achievable 5%. The only inflation representative that was moving was the target. Basically, it wasn't doing anything, and it was pretty laughably ineffective. It's like yelling sit at your dog and patting yourself on the back every time he squats over to poop on your carpet before running away. Hey, a squat's almost a sit. Step in the right direction. I'm the one in charge. Instead, they were going to use a different metric that they could actually claim to have some control over. Monetary supply. The new mission of the Argentine government was to ensure that nobody took any money out of their bank to spend in the economy. Starting October 1st, as stipulated in the standby agreement with the IMF, the bank abandoned its previous inflation targeting regime to adopt a rigid monetary rule, which consists of keeping the monetary base unchanged until June 2019. This new monetary rule thus sets a 0% monthly growth for the monetary base. Just seriously, don't touch your money. We won't give you an 80% savings account rate. Just stop buying stuff. Unfortunately, a combination of people locking up their money and the government making severe cuts to the budget contracted the economy pretty substantially, which led to an outcome more predictable than Bond killing the bad guy at the end of the movie.
Argentine President Mauricio Macri admitted after last weekend's resounding defeat in presidential primaries that they had a bad election.
What? He lost? When this happened, though, what most Argentinians heard was, there's probably going to be a return to currency control soon, so buy dollars on the open market while you legally still can. We don't want to have to go back to dealing with our dollar dealer again if they close access to foreign currency markets. Now this led to, a massive run on the Argentine peso, which floored its value even worse. Right after this loss, it was almost like something just snapped in President Macri's mind, because within a few weeks he had reversed literally years of work, starting with a reversal on his core policy. On September 2nd of this year, after a complete inability to control the peso's decline, we saw
Argentina will restrict foreign currency purchases to try and stabilize markets as the country faces a deepening financial crisis. Firms will have to get permission from the central bank to sell pesos, to buy foreign currency, and to make transfers abroad.
So that happened. What an extraordinary waste of time, money, and suffering there. The economy minister, Nicolas Jovan, who negotiated the IMF deal, resigned on August 17th, and the government rolled out plans for tax breaks, minimum wage increases, and freezing fuel prices with subsidies. Now, how they plan to increase the amount they pay with these increases and decrease the amount they earn with tax cuts, while literally anybody would be insane to buy their bonds, is beyond me. But I think they still have some IMF money rattling around in the bank. At the same time, in late August, the government announced it would postpone $7 billion in payments on short-term local bonds while pushing for a maturity extension on $50 billion in longer-term debt, mostly held by foreign investors. The government is also seeking to delay payments of $44 billion of IMF loans. Since Argentina is currently on the verge of a default, the IMF holds all the cards in its hand. 80% of the IMF loan is being used to provide dollars to pay down foreign debt, so that Argentina doesn't have to ship over literal tons of pesos to make payments. That basically means they're using one credit card to pay off another, and this new IMF one has some pretty demanding terms and conditions. The new government right now is in talks to try to make peace with the IMF, but saying that increased austerity is not an option. Still, the IMF could just say, "Nah, we want austerity, or we won't give you the money," forcing you into austerity measures. We'll see how those talks go. With those currency controls back in place, I will say that the peso has steadied, at a terrible rate, but it's not in decline anymore. And finally, trying to earn some goodwill with Latin America, Donald Trump has announced that he's gonna help Argentina. I'm just kidding.
Before departing for the NATO summit in London, US President Donald Trump reinstated tariffs on steel and aluminium imports from Brazil and Argentina because of their currency devaluations.
Yeah, Donald Trump's gone on record a weird amount of times calling Argentina a currency manipulator and saying that he thinks Argentina is intentionally decreasing the value of their currency. And a few weeks ago, imposed tariffs on their exports in response. So that's exactly how Argentina got into the crisis they're in today. Sorry that this episode was probably longer than even a John Oliver segment, but when you sit me in front of a computer and ask me to summarize an economic situation, I just go. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I'd like to thank my fine patrons over here for helping me put out my videos. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news looking the overlooked, join this growing group of individuals by clicking the link in the description. Remember to subscribe, because if I can get 1,000 of you, I can put my Patreon link as an icon in this part of the video. And wouldn't that just be beautiful somewhere right over here? Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.